Good morning. Happy New Year and welcome to Bedford Presbyterian Church. It's wonderful to have you here this morning, and I hope that you're able to stay warm and comfortable in this place as we gather and worship God. There are a number of things in your order of worship. There is a chance to pledge. The stewardship drive is still going on, and so you may be a part of that. The little QR barcode, is that right, QR? Is that it? Yeah, you can. We all know how to do that now with the menus and everything, so you can get to the website. We are so thankful for the flowers. Thank you, Gordon and Judy, who have dedicated the flowers as best wishes to friends and family in 2023. The children's offering will be Sunday, January 15th. Soon after that, on January 20th, there will be a midnight run, and you're welcome to go ahead and donate to that. What they do is they will go to set designated places in the city and make sure that people who need coats and scarves and gloves and underwear and all sorts of items are able to get those. So please look at the information there. There's a winter youth group schedule that is set up, and the confirmation class is coming up. Also, there are a number of people who are wishing to join the church right now. So if you would like to join the church, we have a class of people coming up. And so please let me know. You can sign it in the pew pad, or you can just let me know after the service if you're interested in joining. We have a beautiful group coming up, and anybody online as well. We always have folks who are online. You can read a little bit about baptism, and this is Baptism of the Lord Sunday, and it's also, we're still kind of celebrating Epiphany. Epiphany happened on Friday, so we celebrated it last week and a little bit this week. Gives us a chance to spread it a little bit. And so you will be getting chalk, I think, after the service.
Yes.
Yes, okay. And Courtney, did you want to tell us a little bit about that, the chalk?
Is this working? Oh, now it is. All right. Yes, at the end of worship, everybody is going to receive a piece of chalk as well as a little piece of boxwood branch to remember our baptism, and then a slip of paper. On that paper is a prayer to bless your house. Traditionally, at Epiphany, it's also the start of a new year. People, Christians, for thousands of years have been blessing their homes. The blessing each year is the year, so 2023, and then it's C, M, and B, which stand for both the names of the three magi, so Caspar, Melchior, and Balthazar, and then also the Latin phrase Christus Mansionem Bendicat, which means may Christ bless this house.
We have it all written down.
It's all written down.
In case you didn't get that. And that's why I had Courtney explain it, because I still don't remember. So are there any other announcements? Anything that I've forgotten? I want to thank the youth who put together the chalk and helped us set up for communion and worship. There is nothing else. There are pew pads at the end of your aisle during the service. You can pick them up, sign your name, pass them to the person next to you. You can also have a chance to write down any prayer requests. We take those very seriously. pray for them at staff, or if it's confidential, I pray for them. If there are no other announcements, let us feel our feet on the ground, connect to that ground of all being, breathe in the Ruach, the Spirit, and let us worship God. I invite Fiona.
In the beginning, darkness covered the deep, while a wind from God swept over the waters. In the voice of the prophet, God said, "When you pass through the waters, I will be with you." When Jesus was baptized by John, suddenly the heavens were opened, and a voice said, "You are my beloved. With you I am well pleased."
The voice of God is over the waters.
You may be seated. As we come together, we often carry guilt, and sometimes we swallow it, internalize it, and it becomes a shame that we carry. And yet, God is gracious, and God has forgiven us, and we can let go of that guilt and that shame, and we can feel the loving embrace of God as we come together and confess. Imagine it, letting it go. Let us confess together. God of grace, in baptism you promise forgiveness and new life, making us a part of the body of Christ. We confess that we hold on to our guilt and shame. We become preoccupied with ourselves and separated from one another. We cling to destructive habits, hold grudges, and turn each other away. We allow our past to hold us captive. In your love, have mercy on us and free us. Help us to embrace the promises of our baptism so that we might live as your beloved children. My friends, you are children of God. You are beloved, and God is well pleased with you. May the peace of Christ be with you all. Let us share the peace with one another.
Will the children please come forward for the time with children? Good morning to all of you. So when we go out to Sunday Spirit in a few minutes, we are going to talk about Jesus' baptism and how dramatic it was. But the thing that I want you to think about right now is at the end of Jesus' baptism, what God says to Jesus and to all the people watching is, "You are my son, you are beloved, and with you I am well pleased." And when God says this to Jesus at his baptism, this is something that we can also think that God says about us, that we are God's beloved, God loves us, and God is well pleased with us, which means God is happy with us. So when we remember our baptism today, we're going to do it with a lot of pomp and circumstance. It's going to be fancy. But we can think about our own baptisms every day when we're doing something as simple, whenever we're doing something with water, whether that's brushing our teeth, we're washing our hands. We encounter water every day, and it's an opportunity to think about our baptism and remember that God loves us and God is happy with us, and we make God happy. So can we remember that sometime every day when we do something with water? Yeah? Okay. Then let's pray. Repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for showing us how much you love us. Help us to remember this always. Amen. And let's head out to Sunday Spirit.
The Hebrew Bible lesson is from Isaiah chapter 42, verses 1 through 9. Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I have put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry out or lift up his voice or make it heard on the street. A bruised heel he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring justice. He will grow faint. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God, the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord. That is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass, and new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them.
The gospel lesson is from Matthew chapter 3, verses 13 through 17. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then he consented. When Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw God's Spirit descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from the heavens said, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased."
It's like walking through the woods. It's so cool. I've been just so thankful for everybody who made the Christmas services possible, the choir and John and the staff and everyone. So thank you for that. Let's pray. Oh God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are strength, our rock, our liberator. Amen. So Christmas time, for me, always comes with a hint of sadness. When I was in my senior year of college, I went to a Christmas party, and when I began walking through the apartment, I went to the back room, and I saw my friend. He was sitting in a dark room with just the television on. It was so strange for him to be back there because he was always the life of the party. I had met him my first week of college, and as a freshman, I was always jogging along the gym, and he would stop, quit lifting weights, and he would walk beside me because he was much taller than I was and laugh at me about how short my legs were. And he was just the kind of person that made me laugh all the time. We would talk for as long as I could endure running, which has never been very long. So it was strange to find Paul in a back room. It was strange because he was typically the center of every party, his wonderful sense of humor. And yet he was isolated there, completely estranged from everyone, everything, staring at the television. I walked in, surprised, startled, tried to talk with him, and he answered with one-word replies. He never took his eyes off the program. So I sat down with him for a bit, stared at the glowing screen, hoping somehow we could talk about something that was going on in the program. But his funk continued. After a bit, I kind of worried that I was bothering him. I wondered if he just wanted to be alone. So I wanted to honor his privacy. I wished him well, told him to have some happy holidays, and left him. I think that goodbye is one of the greatest regrets in my life, because a few days later, Paul put his Jeep into a garage and started the engine and breathed in those toxins, and I never saw him again. It's been decades now, but I still miss him. For years, when I would walk into a crowded room and I would see somebody about his height with his hair, I would light up and I'd want to go up to the stranger because I thought I saw Paul. And then I realized it wasn't him, it was just my mind playing tricks on him. The whole awful reality would come back to me. I just have been haunted by that night, wondering if there was something I could have done, something I could have said that might have connected with him. Was there anything that would have made him feel less isolated? My heart aches as I recall how he was alone in the midst of that party. That feeling of isolation, I've had it before, it can be soul-sucking. That estrangement that overcomes us. Connection is so important. There were so many things that unfolded around Paul's life that I became aware of in the next few weeks. Those things that brought him to that desperate place. His girlfriend had broken up with him. His career wasn't working out as he hoped. He thought he was a disappointment to his family. He felt estranged from God. He had grown up in a very conservative religion, and he felt like he could never live up to those expectations. His dad was a minister, and so all of that became compounded. He was cut off from God himself, his loved ones, in so many profound ways. And maybe it's just that time of year. but I think of Paul. And when we come to baptism and communion, I remember him. For they are reminders of our connection. And we get a certain perspective when we celebrate the meal and when we celebrate baptism. And it's like one of those satellite cameras where you zoom out from your own individual life, the minute stress of your job or your family and your relationships. We begin to get perspective. And we remember our bonds with loved ones, with our congregation, our community, our world, even the earth that we live in. We become overwhelmed sometimes with the budget numbers, the tasks, the status markers. And yet these sacred sacraments remind us that we're rooted and connected to a meaning and a purpose beyond ourselves. Jesus uses these everyday elements to powerfully bond us to a meaning, a love, a purpose. Water is powerful, it's sacred, and it's becoming scarce. About 58% of our bodies are made up of water, and it runs through our veins, quite literally. We don't have enough water to drink, we become thirsty. If we ignore the thirst, we become sick. We can throw up, pass out, even die without water. And when John baptized Jesus in the Jordan River, that water flowed from that point in history to us in this great connection. And when Jesus came out of the water, he heard a voice from the heavens saying, "This is my son, my beloved, in whom I am well pleased." And that message, it echoes, it reverberates, it extends to all of us. And when we remember our baptism, we become connected to that truth. We are no longer estranged. You are God's child. God is well pleased with you. And no matter how isolated we have felt, when we have felt completely alone in a crowd of people, when we get bogged down with the anxieties of work, when we feel rejected by those whom we love, we remember that ultimate connection at times like this. We remember how we are connected to God, the ground of all being. We remember that every step we take, the ground will hold us and support us. It is a fascinating thing, as Mary Beth Albright, the author of Eat and Flourish, writes, "We know more about the movement of celestial bodies than we know about our soil. One teaspoon of healthy soil has more microorganisms than there are humans on this earth." The ground, it's amazing. And our minds, as technologically advanced as we have become, can barely fathom the ground that we walk on. And then we inhale the spirit of God. Our mythologies say that we have been created from the dust of the earth. We have been formed by it. And then God breathed life, wind, spirit into us. And so as we breathe in, we remember our connection with that spirit. And in this time of COVID and RSV, we have become even more reminded of how precious that breath is. Then when we share this baptism, with Jesus. We know that we're connected to the water, the words, the earth, the spirit, and with those words, you are God's beloved, and you, God, is well pleased. I never saw Paul again, but I know he has that deep connection and longing. It's been fulfilled, the one that he was yearning for. I don't know exactly how it happens, but I do believe that he is in the arms of God, who created him, who loved him, who breathed life into him, and now holds him and embraces him. And I believe we have that same connection. My friends, we are beloved, and God is very pleased with us. Amen. As we come together, we remember that everything we have and everything we are belongs to God, and we have a chance in gratitude to give back a piece of that.
Thank you.
O God, our Creator, giver of life, of breath, of support, we thank you for all that we have and all that we are. And we ask, O God, that you will help us to share our many blessings. Through Jesus, amen. You may be seated. At this time, we will be remembering our baptism, and the kids are going to help us with that. They have pieces of boxwood. So you didn't know you were going to get a second shower today, but you are. So the children will go and they will sprinkle us at when the time comes. Are you guys ready? Yeah? Okay. Hopefully it won't be too much of a shower. Let us remember our baptism. Siblings in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, God's Spirit has been poured out upon the water. Water poured over and immersing us. Water that flows freely for all of those who receive it. Water from the streams of God. Water that brings hope to all who thirst. Water that refreshes life, nurtures growth, and offers new birth.
Today, we come to the waters to renew our commitments in each other's presence, to Christ who has raised us, the Spirit who has birthed us, and the Creator who is making all things new.
Almighty God, the life you birthed in us by baptism into Jesus Christ will never die. Your justice never fails. Your mercy is everlasting, and your healing river flows. Your Spirit blows where you will. We are dry and thirsty, O God. Come, refresh us. You guys ready? Okay. You can be seated.
Do I come up?
No, you can be seated. You can sit. You're good.
You can sit.
Okay. You guys ready?
You're good.
Thank you.
Friends, remember that you are God's beloved, and God is well pleased with you.
We come to table together. As God's beloved, remembering those open and welcome arms, as we come, people will come here from the north and the south and the east and the west, and all are welcome here. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. For Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We lift up our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right to give you thanks and praise, O God, for you have created us from the dust of the earth and you breathe life into us. And though we stray from your ways, you call us back over and over again. And Jesus came, bringing life and light and bringing us abundance. As he gathered with his friends, he made eating and drinking with them a sacrament, and connected us with water and grain and grape. And so we celebrate together, being connected by these elements and connected to each other. Oh God, we give you thanks, for we are no longer estranged, but we are friends and family and children of God. We know that on the night that Jesus was arrested, he came together with his friends and he took bread and he broke it and he gave it to them and he said, "Take, eat, for this is my body broken for you." And in the same way, he took the cup and he poured it out and he gave it to them and he said, "This is my blood. This is a new covenant, a new relationship for the forgiveness of sins." And as often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we remember Jesus and his coming. Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Friends, please join me in prayer. Gracious God, today we come here in moments of sacrament, remembering our baptism, God's Spirit poured out over the water, God's Spirit poured over these elements, the bread of life and the cup of salvation that nourish us spiritually as they nourish us physically, reminding us how beloved we are, reminding us how we please you. Gracious God, continue to be with us. Dwell within us as Christ dwelled within the world, reminding us that we, as your baptized people, come here to live out your justice and your mercy, to experience the healing waters and the life of the living water. We pray this all in Christ Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please join us after the service. We have soup in the fellowship hall, so we would love to see you there, get to know you better. We spend all of our days learning what we could do better, learning what we should have done, could have done, fighting the perfectionism that we grew up with. And yet we spend this hour resting in the reality that God is pleased with you. No matter who you are, no matter what you have done, God loves you. You are God's beloved. Now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you and give you peace. Amen.